Welcome back to ClayshareCon 2024, everyone. And we are really excited to have Jeff from JR Pottery Forms joining us for a third session today. I can't believe we're already in the third session. He is going to show us how to do RD2 dinner plates. Now, the RD2 forms, if you haven't checked those out yet, you need to. Jeff has some great deals going on, but they're this really lovely slope to them. So he's going to show us how to use them. Here's a couple plates I made with them. Back has texture, the front just gorgeous glaze. Here's another one I did right here. Look at the glazing on that. But then the back, texture. What? And these are from slabs, so these are really great. And then if you want to carve, well, I have the ones behind me, and then this one right here is done with Sgraffito, so I just carved in. There's the back. So these were all made with these forms right here. So Jeff is going to go ahead and tell us more about them and how to use them. So hey, Jeff, how you doing?
Hello, hello, everybody. Oh, it's
welcome
so good to be here.
Welcome to ClayshareCon. Woohoo!
Woohoo! Yay! 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 Oh, I watched some of the videos last night, and excited about your whole thing. 5 years. It's amazing how fast it goes.
5 years. I know, and I'm so glad you're here with us.
Yeah. And so, you know, it's good and bad that I like to have two segments because, you know, there's so much information, so much to talk about. But to kind of fine tune what I think that you guys would be the most interested in, and for me, what is the most successful results with the forms right now that we have. And so it's our new RD2, which aren't really that new. It's about a year old, maybe. But they're the rounded 2-inch edge forms.
Is that why the 2 is in there?
Yes.
That's round, why it's the RD2-inch. Oh, my gosh.
2-inch edge. So we've got some posers out there that are trying to be like JR Pottery Forms, but they may have rounded edges, but these have a 2-inch edge. So that's critical. And
Jeff is the OG.
The OG.
You are the OG.
Speaking of, it's a 5-year for ClayShare, but it's going to be our 10-year at Inseca for 2014. Yeah. And I remember, I think it's kind of a fun fact. I kind of wish maybe I would have trademarked the, and I don't know if I would have been able to, but the word forms is a word that I came up with. Like when I was first making these, I was like,
what are you going to call them? Right. Oh, Jeff, we lost your audio. Can you hear me? We lost you. We'll get just a moment, everyone. Jeff's going to get it fixed. So.
Seems like everything's working over here.
Oh, I can hear you now. You're back.
Yeah.
Now you're back. I don't know what happened. Who knows? Now you're gone again. I know. He's gone again. So we lost the audio again. I'm not sure what happened. You came back for a sec and then it went out. I can't hear him at all. Jeff, you need to learn sign language, and you could sign it to everybody. Yeah. All right. Well, I will talk a bit about the RD2 forms if you want. I can talk over while Jeff figures it out. And if you would like. Why not? I'm here. I'll do it. So, wait. Yeah, I can hear you now. We got him back. So we can go back to Jeff.
We lost our Wi-Fi connection. So,
that would make sense. We all are at the mercy of technology. It's, you know,
that's why we need this earthly substance, right? This thing right here.
That's why we need clay.
Back to the ground. Yeah. This is the important part. I think are we good? Good now, I think.
Yes, we're good. Go all for right. It.
Woo, woo, woo.
Woo, you'll start over. Yay.
Yay. Yeah. So, yeah, what I was talking about. Oh,
you're talking about the word forms. You were talking about copywriting the word forms.
Oh, yeah. See, that just shut down the internet.
Came up with them
right?
in 2014.
That's exactly what happened. It shut down the internet. Oh, no. So, anyway, so it's kind of a proud moment for me and for us here, the 10-year anniversary at Inseca. So, I was hoping for a big something to do, but we'll try
do
to
you
make
want a cake?
Fun.
Shall I make you a cake?
No, no cake.
I'll bring cake. I'm driving. Good, I could pick one up. And
Yes. <Aww. laughs> But yeah, so today, talking about these new kind of, where I think maybe the next 10 years will go is to these kind of more rounded edge forms. And because they're so versatile and so many options. And like, you just saw Kathy's little talk and all the different ways to like put stuff on clay and print on clay. So you have so many options of making these really fun plates that, you know, that you can put whatever kind of life you want into it. So I think it's, I get on my soapbox, and I was talking about this in Alabama, and I thought it was kind of relevant. But, you know, I always, when I first started in clay, and I think a lot of you out there are starting, but, and people kept saying you need to have a voice or you need to have a story on your pieces, and that's what really makes them sell. And over all these years, I've kind of finally figured out what that really means. And it's basically making your clay become alive by telling a story, by having a certain pattern. So like, I know Kathy was just on, loves to have fish on her pieces because she lives by the coast, and fish is a big part of her life. So it gives her a reminder, a story. It makes that clay and your work kind of come alive. Debbie makes some wonderful like word sayings and stuff and stamps that helps your piece to kind of tell a story, to like have a purpose beyond just being a functional plate. And us as makers, we can make those decisions. And that really helps people to know and connects us. There's an artist here in town who was, he had a hard time kind of making it, selling his work. And he was huge into Star Wars, and all of his work kind of represented Star Wars stuff, but he didn't want to tell the public. He thought that was a secret. And now he's not, somebody said, no, you got to tell everybody that. That's the passion. So you can share that life and that passion with other people. And so now he can't make stuff fast enough because it's all this care. He explains how it's inspired by Star Wars, or, you know, what the little lines mean or where they're coming from in the Star Wars kind of scene. So, yeah. So our little soapbox, little psychology story here, maybe to kind of get us kind of in the calm mind of after all this information we've been receiving. So hopefully I'm not putting you to sleep, but so that's why I think clay can be so important and relevant. It can kind of tell your story and help you to kind of connect with other people that have the same story as you. So yeah. And Jessica and Kevin do amazing job of connecting you guys. So it's this is where it is. It's so clay is a connector. You know, we have this technology which kind of fails us, but this clay, it's gonna stay here forever. So yeah.
And you know, it's your story is told through the shapes you make and the patterns and textures you use. So you create your own language. I mean, that's as simple as that. The things you like make your story, right? Make your the language you use. So just by putting a design on something that you love, that's you. That's you telling your story.
Mm-hmm. And I think this is the other thing too, where I think GR Pottery Forms really help you to kind of give you a structure and foundation of your pieces, so that you can focus on that story. But then
exactly.
But I also want to encourage you too, like, you know, don't try to make your right. Especially when people start, they want their piece. They want their friends to think they're the best potters in the world, or people that are watching them. Just make what you make and enjoy it. If you just smile while you're making it, it's going to be much more alive and much more beautiful. Be yourself. Don't worry about like making mistakes or did something wrong. I think, oh shoot, now what's her name from Sandbao?
Ying?
Ying, yeah, putting the material onto the clay in a joyful way, and you become, then your piece really reflects that joy. So, so little soul box. But again, don't try to worry about making these perfect edges or these, be where you're at and be comfortable in that and have fun doing it. You don't have to stress about, it's got to do it just right, just formula. And thankfully the forms are really good to kind of bring you in and kind of focus you on this kind of size of object or shape of object, and kind of defines things a little bit for us. I really need them for my brain that, you know, is bouncing all over directions. So it kind of pulls me in and like, okay, this is what I'm going to do. Otherwise I can never get anything done if I just work on each all individual project. So there's fun to make, work in quantity as well. Like, making 10 of something is really different than making one of 10 different shapes. And so that can be really helpful to you in your journey of making things. Try to perfect it before you kind of move to the next step. So that's another thing too. Don't feel like you have to make this huge dinnerware set for everybody that you know and your grandkids or your kids. Just make 16 plates that then you feel comfortable with making all those 16 plates kind of look similar and what you're liking. So, and yeah. So don't be overwhelmed by all the options. I think too, this is a great platform here to kind of help decide on what those things are that you, to like what glazes to put on your piece. Because as you can see, there's like zillions of options. So just use what you have, and it's going to be amazing. It's perfect. So yeah, sorry. I was going to get some high octane coffee this morning and I'd probably start chatting a little too much.
And did you? Did you?
Have,
yeah.
I did. So. Yep. So anyway, but I love it. I love this feeling of my mind kind of thinking about what, you know, what's happening and, you know, where I'm going as opposed to where I am. Because it goes a lot straighter where. Thinking about dreaming. I'm a dreamer.
same. You know, yes. You make what you love. And, you know, I always believe that if you do something and you put your heart and soul into it, others will see that. And if you're making work to sell, people will buy your joy. They'll buy that. And exactly. They love it too because they know you made it because you love doing it. So it'll be there. And perfection does not matter. None of that matters. Although your forms really help. I mean, you make it easy for us.
Oh, yes. So good. So now back on to what I'm actually going to do here today. I'm going to make first just a hand-built plate, not using a wheel. And then I'm going to incorporate another form and still use the RD2 to make a plate similar to like this with a round center and kind of a spherical rectangle outside, or square, I guess it would be. And then I'm going to use the end, use a wheel to make a plate on that as well. So if you don't have a wheel, and it's totally good, you don't have to have a wheel to make any of the stuff that we have. I still use the wheel attachment system sometimes just to kind of hold everything together, but we really don't need to have that. So. All we need is a piece of clay, a board, and this yellow rib really helps to kind of compress the clay. So as you saw, I just made sure that I compressed the clay in two directions, making sure that those clay particles are collected together so that they stay together when they go through the firing. If they're kind of separate and kind of wavy and uneven, then your piece can kind of go all directions in the firing when it's under pressure. So I just take the piece of clay and I really think I have the most control. There's so many people out there that use foam or something else, similar techniques. All that's good. You can figure out what way works best for you. But what I found for me to have the most control is just to take the clay and drape it over the form. And then I have the control of the pressure, how even it is. And then I can, especially bigger, more technical pieces, I can really be in control of how that clay is moving and being compressed against the form. And so now you can maybe see this texture on the clay. What I want to do now is compress on this side so that I get the pressure that I need. And it's about that compression. I just have been kind of thinking recently, and I got to make a chart, but it's funny, like doing these demos and teaching and getting questions from people and comments really kind of helps to kind of figure out like how to make things better for everyone. And one of those things was to think about the time of drying in a chart mathematically. And I'm not a big mathematician, but sometimes those things really do help us. And so thinking about this, the clay from right out of the bag to bone dry as 100%, you know, and, you know, it may take us 10% of the time to make the piece. And, but the critical part of warping is that from 10 to 100%. And so that can be really, really critical in warping. So there's so many factors along 100% time, along that time scale of, you know, where we're at. So now I'm just going to take my clay, and in this case, I'm going to make kind of a rectangle shaped plate. So this is the part where you can, you know, kind of define what you're hoping for, going for with, your statement of what the piece is. So now I can take a foot maker, and this is the handmade method. You can just take one of these foot cutters, which is the old corn skewer. Jess has a class on how to make these, on how to.
But you have them, right, for sale. People could buy forms, yeah, and just pick one up. They don't have to make one. I mean, my class, I use power tools. It's a little scary. I think a lot of people have commented that they were worried for me, but you can just buy one from Jeff and not worry about it. And you can watch the class for fun. So
there you go. There you go. Yeah. Either way, all these options, right? We're going to make your life easier.
Exactly.
Yep. Yeah. And I really love to make people happy. That's what I, you know, I'm happier when other people are happy, right?
Absolutely.
So if you're happier making it yourself, that's awesome. If you're happier buying it from me, me helping you make it for you, that's good too. But then I can put other people to work making them and delivering them. And so, yeah, so it all is good. So I'm just going to add this foot and this clay, and We don't have too much time, so a little limited time, and all this stuff is a process, right? So, I would just wait. I just feel how wet this clay is, so I'm not even going to fuss with kind of cleaning up the edges anymore. But one thing I am going to do is I'm going to add a spacer, and this is really more for information. Spacers. Everybody wonders what spacers are for, right? This block of wood, and they think, oh man, this is a cheap form. I can save some money. And these are some experimental ones I have back here in my shop. So ignore the holes in them. These are just, I just drilled holes for some other reason. But you basically have a 1/4 inch and a 1/2 inch. And what this helps to do is when you're making a piece with a lip on it, we can take the, make it, separate it from the board a little bit. This clay is really wet. So what I can do is just put the spacer underneath here, and that will help me to make a nice angle on this outside edge. I really only need it for a piece that would have a lip, maybe a front angle here. You can kind of see how it kind of goes downward. So really just by that space, that gap under there, it can control the angle of what the lip is going to be. So if I have a longer angle, like maybe a 2-inch lip, then maybe I would want to use a 1/2-inch one. But you can see I can just develop this nice little plate. And what I love about these options is I can make this edge on the outside whatever I want the edge to be. It could be a bunny. It could be a tree. It could be have a real kind of natural edge, a live edge, they call it now, right, in the woodworking world. But a way to kind of, again, this kind of match a kind of style or whatever we're going for. But, yeah.
So, Jeff, did you do a bunny with us last year in ClayShareCon?
I might have. Actually, you know, I think it remember was two years ago.
I remember bunny. We did a bunny plate. I can't remember either. Maybe it was 2 years ago. Wow.
I think, yeah, two or three, maybe. I know it wasn't last year. It's been five years, Jeff.
No, yeah, I know. Oh, my gosh.
It might have been year two.
No, I think it was at least year three. It has to have been.
Yeah, that's what I think too. Yeah.
Because I think we were over here. It could have been. So I just want to remind everybody, Jeff has 20% off all items for the conference, for the days of the conference only. You don't need to use a code. You go to grpotteryforms.com and you can just buy everything. It's already 20% off.
Yeah. So
just if you want to get the kit and all the stuff, he has kits. And you can get yourself set up and start making forms. Jeff has a ton of videos on his YouTube and on your Instagram and your Facebook.
And,
right?
And back to the automatic sale. Sometimes it already might say on there like it's on sale. But that may be a little deceiving. What that means is if it's a 5-pack, it's the sale price for buying 5 of them at one time. And so the regular price is if you bought them individually. So if it says a sale price, you're going to get 20% off that sale price. So it's not just the, and it comes at the end on your order. So it may not tell you, you know, what that discount is until the very end. So, and you don't worry if you get to the end, you can always go back. You don't, you know, you don't have to, you can, don't worry that, once you get to the end. But also too, make sure that you double check your address. We get this a lot. All this fancy stuff our computers do for us, it inputs all this information. Make sure you double check that to make sure it's going to the right place. That shipping address is where you want it to be shipped, and that the billing address is what your credit card is attached to. So, yeah. So off, you know, a couple times a week that happens around here. So make sure you double check, double check, double check. So, yeah. All right. Here's something I don't always use. You're getting special Jeff here today.
Oh, special Jeff. I heard the high octane coffee brings us the special Jeff.
Yes, you're right. So I really kind of the secret's out. I'm not a big fan of pre-cutting slabs because then I have to fuss with it and have to kind of line it all up. But in this case, I am going to pre-cut a slab for you and just give you some pointers on that. One thing is we have these ink stamps, and notice for us to use like a stamper, it has to be a water color ink, apparently, according to my printer guy. And sometimes that can bleed into the clay if you get it wet. So if you flip this over and have it stamp side onto the clay, it might moisten that stamp and transfer, and people are like, what's gonna happen to the clay? Oh no, it'll be fine, it'll burn out, but kind of creates this mess. But if you put it upside down like this and just run along the edge, that stamp isn't gonna be a problem, and it's much easier to lift it off from the clay because it's got this nice little kind of edge here. So And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my, and I'm using, I think these are all 8-inch. Yeah, these are all 8-inch RD2s that I'm using today. So I'm giving you a variety of ways to make them, but now I'm going to kind of eyeball this in center. I think part of the reason I don't like the pre-cut is I'm already kind of making those decisions for me. And I always change my mind. So it's way better if I can have an out. And I don't, and then commit. Who likes committing, right? But I'm doing it. Special Jeff got a little extra coffee today, and we're doing it. Pre-cutting the slab.
Whoa. That's, I know, you never pre-cut slabs. I don't know what's happening.
Oh, all right. So now you see I have it on the board here. And my edges are pretty good here. This is one thing I'm also bad at. I'm going to do it. Oh, man, you're getting a little bit
what's
of
gonna
a
happen?
Sponge. Jeff's using a sponge. Don't take notes. Cleaning that edge just a little bit. I'm trying to be like Jess. Jess is the master. I'm not always the master at those things. So, yeah. Actually, I already messed it up. See? I'm not used to using a sponge. But it's pretty good. I was going to release it a little bit from the clay here, from the board, before I smoothed it out again. But be really cautious for adding moisture to slabs. It's not that it's a problem. It's not that it's a bad thing. It's just, I think you'll have an easier time without the moisture on there because the clay will react kind of more evenly. So now I can take the Wah-2 system.
Wah-2.
Which is this system with the board here and the key. And I can put the key on there, and I'm only going to use, maybe I better use 2 in this one. Oh, no. Everything's going. Why do I try to do all these fancy things on a...
That's too much. Your coffee's, I don't know.
So I better put the second pin in there. And because I'm using the RD2, and because I'm pre-cutting the slab, that's the main reason.
That's what sets you up. Yeah.
And so now I can just put this on top here and do the old flipperoo. We have these fun boards that are great for mainly for this flip purpose. They're lightweight. They kind of can get some movement from time to time, but
I just want to tell everybody, I shared the link to Jeff's demo from, it was 2 years ago, you did the bunny plate. It was actually Unexpected Edges was the title of it. And in that, you also did the bunny plate during ClayShareCon. So 2 years ago, ClayShareCon, bunny plate, and Unexpected Edges. So folks, I shared that. You can just watch it later.
The bunny is funny. I was at Sacramento. Because it was during Sacramento.
It was 2 years ago.
Yeah.
No, Sacramento was last year. California and Seca was last 2023.
No, Cincinnati last year. Sacramento
was Cincinnati?
The year before.
Oh, that's right. I didn't go to either. Yeah. So, wow.
I remember this
flies.
Template. It was just a paper hand drawn template. And
that's right.
Somebody walked up and thought I was just handing them out, and she just walked away with it. And I was like,
she took your template. Did you have to chase her down?
Where'd my template go? Oh, so I just made a new one. Somebody out there has got
somebody's got the original bunny.
Yeah, somebody in Sacramento. She's sipping her wine in Napa right now.
With the bunny.
Bunny template. Yeah. Napa is really close to Sacramento. That's why I brought that up. All right. So now I kind of compress those
Look
edges.
Look at that.
Woo-hoo. And I have this outside edge, but I have this circular edge. So now I'm going to add this to the wheel to add a foot on the bottom. And so I heard a little birdie told me that you're giving away an Artista wheel.
We are. Yes, we're giving away an Artista wheel on Saturday. And you can use the wah on the Artista wheel.
Yes.
You got the splash pan off it, I see.
I
do. For better demoing.
Yeah, so I am a huge fan of this wheel. Big time. And
you know, it goes in a camper. Did you know you could put that in a camper?
Yeah.
And go, and you could travel all over with a camper and that wheel, making pots.
Or you could get, you know, or you could get your minivan and put like six of these in the back, and you could go from school to school or library to library and teach pottery classes.
Yes. You absolutely. Yeah. And the new L&L kiln plugs into 120. You could just fire all the pots in that.
Ooh.
Getting better
all these
and better.
Good things. Yes. So many options. So now what I'm going to do is, I think what really helps with this wheel situation here is to be able to measure where the foot is going to go. So I'm going to use my sous tool here. And it's got this fancy little measuring. It's real fancy. This math compass. So we got an eight inch plate here, 8-inch form. And what I can do is I can just make it so it touches the. I might have to stand up for this. Touches the middle there. So what this is helping me do is to measure. Where this spot is, because it's really difficult to see when the clay is over top. So now what I did was I just measured this little line by using my sous tool and figuring out the radius of this diameter. And it, now I can. And the main thing is really is that I. Because of this little measuring gauge, I can repeat this over and over and over again. So now I have, I don't have to measure the size of this, the plate. I got the form that will do that for me. I have this that'll measure the foot. And we can just go wah, wah, wah all day long.
You should have coffee every day, Jeff. This is.
Well, now you're just seeing the results. So now they told you. Shouldn't have told us.
We just would have thought it was spring is in the air or something. Right.
And this is not an advertisement because it would probably be a lot of money, but my wife was telling me, what kind of coffee is that? And I said, McDonald's. He's like, McDonald's? I'm like, yes, McDonald's.
Iced or hot coffee did you go for?
I went for hot. And I don't have this theory, you know, in me and in my theories. Starbucks and McDonald's, like, they know what we need, you know? I can react this way in a certain way. I'm going to go to McDonald's and get coffee, right?
So, folks that don't know about the wah has little pins where it locks into the wheel head. So you lock that board onto the wheel, and then in the center of your wah is another little hole that has another little pin that sits in, and your form locks into that. So the form isn't moving. It's all locked together with bat pins. And Jeff has done many demos using the wah, and I've done demos using the wah out there, breaking it all down and showing it to everybody. Yeah, there you go. He's getting it for you. Here, he'll explain it.
Yeah, Jessica's doing it great. Like, these are the three parts. These are only three
parts.
There
you go. So there's your part.
This goes in here and locks in here. And then the forms attach in with the pins. And it's just simple pins. There's nothing complicated about it.
The back of the forms all have a hole in the center. So you can line them up with that, and it locks onto the standard bat pin. Yep, there they are. So right there.
We're right in there.
It just holds your form in place. And you do not, you can use the wah system on a banding wheel and just spin it on a banding wheel too, if you don't have a wheel, power wheel.
Right.
Or just use it for registration just to keep everything locked in. You don't have to put it on anything.
Exactly. You know, so it really helps us center this in here for us. And by it being centered, it can really help us to just make that center part a little smoother. So we can't really put, these don't have holes in them because I can't really, it doesn't really make sense to really have it on the wheel. But even though I'm now using this round one to kind of just make that center. And for those that were at Alabama Clay Conference, they served us food on these plates that are almost identical to this. I'm like, oh, that's a lovely plate. I should show people how to make those with RD2s. And I love this J820 tool. They're a little hard to come by right now, but we have thousands of them. I ordered 5,000 of them, literally, because they stopped. They weren't going to sell them to me anymore. I was like, what if I buy 5,000? So, but this little tool, I'm convinced it's the best wood tool.
So do they still make it, or did they stop? They sold them all to you, and you've got the last 5,000, are you saying?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's Kemper. One that sells them has them made. I guess whether they're going to have more made is the real question. So, yeah. So, anyway. All right. And so, you know, the only thing I can kind of watch for is just aesthetically is making sure that this little foot is cleaned up. You saw I didn't put any slip or scoring. The clay is so wet and I want it to slide into place, and now with my compression and shaping with that little wood tool, it's all gonna stand there fine. There's no gravity kind of pulling away. And so here's a fun little thing somebody told me. Is to use a glaze bottle. This one is Amoco, works perfectly. And then you can just push it right on down the side there. Maybe you have a front view of that real quick. And you can see how.
We do. Yeah.
All right.
When I'm making a bunch of plates, have all my. When I'm in the studio and I'm making a bunch of plates like that, I'll have my glaze pints or my speedball underglaze pints, and on top of them all are sitting plates with your forms. They'll be like, Alana, I'll take a photo next time I make a bunch of plates. But it's just so funny to see all these bottles of glazes with plates sitting on top of them drying.
Yeah.
But it's great.
Mm-hmm. And one thing I would say, if we have this lip, we have to kind of, as a slab, we have to kind of manage the slip. Lip. So I might use the spacer again here. Maybe this one is too thick for this angle. So you just want to repeat it over and over again. So I'm going to go back and get another one of these quarter inch spacers. And turn my wheel off so it doesn't go flying. And put this on here. And I think one of the pins still stuck in there. One of them. Forgot there were two. One was hiding in there. So I'm just going to put in this. What does this do? It creates this angle on the outside edge, and we want the angle for your plate to just look better when it's in the kiln, and it just makes it all come together nice. As opposed to having a second mold underneath there to kind of create that, it's just going to use this little chunk of wood. And as long as I use the same.
That's a nice slope. That's nice. That's nice profile.
Yeah, and that's what I feel like, you know, with functional pieces, we really want this kind of welcoming, kind of wonderful place where just asking for food to be put on it or whatever, held, washed. You know, it might encouragement for doing dishes, right? Is a nice, lovely Nice, lovely surface. All right, so we got about 10 more minutes here, I think, or so.
Five. We end at a quarter of, yeah, five. Do it. Right. Compress it, Jeff. You can do it.
Oh, definitely. So I'm just going to go ahead.
Jeff's going to be at Enseca in Richmond coming up in March.
Yeah.
He'll be with us tomorrow for ClayShareCon day 3. But then after that, I will be there with Jeff at Enseca, and I'm going to be at your booth closing Enseca down. You and me, we're going to have the end.
Yeah, close it down. That's so good.
The wrap party.
3 o'clock on Friday, right?
It's the wrap party. Enseca, wrap it up. Yep.
Wrap it up.
Come to the booth. It's going to be a good time.
Yeah, so excited about that. I'm glad you're coming, and looking forward to that. Shelby will be there. Matt will be there. My wife Gretchen will be there.
I don't think I've met. Did I meet? Have I met Gretchen in person?
I don't know if you have. I don't think so. Maybe.
That'd be nice.
Maybe once, like at Enseca or something, but.
Maybe.
Yes. Let's end with a little.
Yeah, how fast can you make? Because you got 3 minutes.
3 minutes. Oh, no problem. We can even add
a 3 minute plate. Right, let's do it.
And I love to add texture. There's so many textures out there, so many fun things. So, but I think it's kind of great to just be able to add different things to your pieces here. So it's fun to just add a little band of texture on the inside of your plate. That, and you could do hand stamps, you could do a little saying, you could have your kids make them, grandkids make them, and put their names on them. All kinds of fun. All right, so now we're gonna line it up a little bit. So what I just want you to know about these RD2s is that they're so versatile. They're great for handling whatever kind of story you want on them. It's kind of a modern style plate, so make all your press all your friends.
With your own handmade plates, that's the best thing.
Yes. All right. I'm fine. Finish this up here. We got like 1 minute.
Minute and a half.
Minute and a half. All right. So now we do a little flip. And these have a locating groove on them, on the bottom, so it's real easy for it to take it off and back on and be able to find that pin so that we can rotate them on and stay on there and register so that it stays in place. With these RD2s, we don't have to worry about the edge kind of thinning out. We can just go right on over the edge, wham, wham, wham. A little compression, 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 and more compression. Don't leave those pretty marks on there. You need the compression more than you need those marks. You can add the marks back on there if you need to, but now I'm just going to cut a foot ring. I'm going to cut it kind of thin because this is kind of a thin, delicate plate. So we will quickly do that. Oh, yeah, one thing we got to do is measure the, thankfully I'm using it the same way. So 2 inch for the, where that, right where that foot needs to go consistently. And then we can just drape this clay right on here. And I would just cut the strip of clay for the amount, how big a foot you want it to be. All right. Well, I can finish this up as we finish talking here.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know, any final questions?
You leave it on until it's ready to flip out. How long does it usually take for you?
Oh, it's a good 4 to 6 hours here in the Midwest for it to set up. I want it to, you know, fully be set up, hold its shape. So it's got to be able to withstand that lifting up and off from the form. tomorrow I'm going to be talking about bowls using these, and I'm super excited about these new bowls. And I'm going to do another thing. I probably will have coffee again tomorrow, but another
thing. Oh no, McDonald's coffee again. Watch out, Jeff.
They said that I won't do, that I wouldn't do, that I'm going to do, I'm going to offer to exclusively to ClayShare members. So come back tomorrow.
We're going to have an exclusive ClayShare. Ooh, a stuff. Okay. I love
option,
it.
Yes.
Well, Jeff, thank you so much for this dinner plate demo and for being with us for day two of ClayShareCon. We'll see you tomorrow for making bowls.
Sounds great. Bye, everybody.
Thanks, Jeff.
Write notes.
Bye, Jeff. All right. Watch. Yes. Lots of notes. The replay will be available. Watch it. I told you they go fast. Some folks were asking for finished plates. Here's a couple that I've made, just like Jeff is showing. So the right here, and the only difference is I put texture on the back of mine. So I left the front smooth when it was on the form, when it was draped. Here's the form it was on. When it was on the form, I went ahead and used my Ginkgo roller and I rolled that around. I actually did it before I put the foot on too. That's how come I have texture in the center. I did a demo on this. And what I created, do you see my edge? Do you see how it's a little uneven, but it's completely finished? It's a live edge. Jeff had mentioned that, live edge in woodworking. Well, we kind of create live edges in pottery, and I love how beautiful that is. So here's a smaller one, and I also did a large one. So I won't put that, well, you can kind of see it. And then there's a big one. So you can make all kinds of different size plates. You know, these are some smaller ones. I could have made them bigger with bigger rims and had a larger plate. I just went with the same size as the form. And in the tutorial I did, I show you how to make these. So you should check that out. I believe that was in a ClayShare Live, which is our free weekly broadcast we do every Wednesday at 5 p.m. So you can check that out. And I did share a link to that bunny plate Jeff made during the Unexpected Edges a couple years ago in ClayShareCon. All right, so 20% off at grpotteryforums.com. And Jeff is giving away three $50 gift certificates. We'll be giving one of those away tonight in our giveaways to some lucky winner. To enter all of our giveaways, you just go to clayshare.com and sign up for our emails. Premium members of ClayShare, you're automatically entered. You don't have to do anything at all. We're going to take a little break. We're actually going to have a recorded video that I did of you showing you the new studio. So we got the studio tour coming up at noon. And then we're going to be back after lunch with Drew from Clayscapes Pottery. And he's going to talk to you about kilns and things you should know before you buy. So I will see you all back here live at 12:30. But at noon, we have the recorded studio tour. We'll see you in a few.